I'm René Gifford. I'm professor of hearing and speech sciences at Vanderbilt University Medical Center in Nashville, Tennessee. Cochlear implants have been called the most successful neural prosthesis to date. And so given that, and knowing how much this can change one's life, we want to offer this technology to more people who could derive benefit. Today's cochlear implant candidate is not the conventional, sort of old-fashioned, severe to profound hearing loss in both ears. We have a variety of people who are pursuing cochlear implantation and deriving significant benefits for communication and quality of life. So I wanted to show the audience that there was a broad array of audiometric profiles and speech perception scores preoperatively that meet candidacy for this technology. And I showed some data that was from about over 500 nucleus cochlear implant recipients that we'd implanted with the most recent generation technology in the last 6 years. And showing that there was a dramatic difference between some of the different electrode choices that we can go with. So for example, Contour Advance or Slim Straight 422 or 522, the new 532, as well as the Hybrid L device. And it's really, as a clinician, practicing clinician, it's a nice option to have such a variety of electrodes that we can choose for our patients. It really allows us to have sort of a personalized approach to audiologic management of our patients. Then we talked about particularly the 532. To date, we have imaged 21 adults who have been implanted with the 532. But using our image processing, we're able to localize the electrodes, each of the individual electrodes in whatever scala they reside, and we can determine the electrode to modiolus distance for each of those. And for those 21 recipients, we've actually seen that not a single 532 has traverse from scala tympani to scala vestibuli. So we typically call that a transscalar location. And there are a number of peer-reviewed papers that have shown a significant decrement in performance associated with transscalar location. So what this means is that with a perimodiolar electrode that has been associated with anywhere from 20 to 30% of transscalar location historically, this new device, we haven't seen a single one. And so it's a really exciting thing for us, showing that our patients are able to get that nice perimodiolar placement, get it placed in scala tympani, and keep it in scala tympani throughout the array. The other exciting thing that we've seen with that device is that we're seeing a much more uniform electrode to modiolus distance between the, basically from the base to the apex. And so what that means is that if you were to calculate the distance in millimeters from each of those electrical contacts to the nearest space on the modiolus surface, it's a much more uniform placement with 532 than we've seen with even Contour Advance and 422 or 522. So we're really excited about that. And you might be asking, well, why are you excited about that? There are a couple of reasons. On a related project, we've been sort of replicating some of the classic literature that was completed in the 90s, looking at how many channels we need to obtain optimized speech perception performance and sound quality with cochlear implants. And so one of my PhD students, Katie Berg, and I have been looking at this and sort of replicating those data, but with modern cochlear implant recipients. So those who had significantly greater residual hearing going into surgery, those who had significantly greater speech recognition scores preoperatively, as well as those who had perimodiolar placement completely located in scala tympani. Two things that we had no idea about in the late 90s, early 2000s. So we took a group of perimodiolar electrodes, the nucleus device, the Contour Advance, that were implanted in scala tympani. We had a group of 7 individuals who were implanted completely in scala tympani, and we had a group of 7 individuals where we were able to confirm transscalar location. And then we replicated the work of Friesen et al. From 2001, where we looked at a number of different channels. So looking at 4 channels, 8 channels, 10, 16, and then 22 channels with 16 maxima. And what we found to date is that we actually do see a statistically significant improvement in speech perception performance and sound quality as you increase your channels from 8 up to 22. And so for years, we've sort of had this assumption that our patients don't need any more than 8 channels. And so we've been using those assumptions to sort of guide our decisions about programming and electrode choices and speech coding strategies. And maybe we didn't have all of the information, or we had information that didn't necessarily pertain to our more modern cochlear implant recipients. That's one thing. The other thing that we found from that research is that those who had cochlear implants completely in scala tympani showed significantly greater outcomes than those who had transcalar location. So what this means is that, going back to the 532, is that if we can get perimodiolar placement and we can keep it in scala tympani, we know that we can get really high outcomes with greater number of independent channels than we had even previously thought possible. Finally, the last thing with respect to the electrode to modiolus distance and being more uniform across the array is that we've been looking at optimized or maximum speech perception performance as it associates with the averaged electrode to modiolus distance across the array. And although these data are preliminary, we are seeing that there is a significant correlation between those electrodes that are located closest to the modiolus and speech perception outcomes. So we know that scala tympani location is associated with higher outcomes, and we're also seeing that more uniform electrode and modiolus distance across the array is also associated with higher outcomes. So this is really influencing our clinical decision making with which electrodes we might be choosing for our patients. So for example, at Vanderbilt University, when we're implanting our patients who are choosing a nucleus device, we're increasingly going to the 532 as sort of our go-to electrode for both adults and children. And we've seen some really great outcomes. What we're getting at is that more people who have hearing losses that are severe, but not necessarily in the profound region, truly can drive significant benefit for communication and overall quality of life with cochlear implants. One of the major things that I would like people to take away is that some of the assumptions we've made about what works and what's appropriate have been based on data that are 20, 30 years old. So I really want to challenge people to look at our current set of data, to look at the new modern day cochlear implant recipient and all of the options and available technology to help them. We know now that we can probably use more than 8 channels. And so that does impact which devices and strategies and what signal coding we're going to be using for our patients. We also know that not everybody who may be considered just a hearing aid candidate, those individuals could actually be cochlear implant candidates and show dramatically improved performance for communication, subjective sound quality, and quality of life following cochlear implantation. So I want us to just challenge the status quo and start thinking about the future in the modern cochlear implant recipient.